Welcome to our session. Really happy to have all of you here. For those in the back, just know that I am a professor also in my life, so I have no problems of calling on people in the back of the room. But if you'd like to come closer, feel free. We're delighted to have you here for our panel. I'm excited for this conversation. I have to say that it actually came out of a panel that we did here at RSA. For those of you who don't know, the open source track is relatively new to the RSA agenda. I think we're 3 years in now, which is really exciting. One of the first 2 years, we did a panel discussion led by the illustrious Ed Moyle, who's here in the room. And the audience started asking questions of that panel about how do you bring open source technologies into the enterprise. And so we percolated on that through the pandemic and decided to bring the conversation to the next level today and talk a little bit more about it. And then as we were all prepping for this panel, we have about four other panel ideas maybe for the next coming years. So consider this an evolving conversation, but we're hoping that you'll bring your questions and your ideas. We've got lots of use cases, lots of things that we're gonna bring to the table, but excited to have you all here. I am Dr. Kelley Misata. I am president and executive director of the Open Information Security Foundation for almost a decade now, which makes me feel very old. We build Suricata. Any Suricata super fans out there? Love you, thank you. There's Suricata stickers at the Stamus booth if you want some, because I gave them all away. Thank you for being here. I'm gonna let my panelists introduce themselves and tell you about their superpowers.
Hi, I'm Srinath Kuruvadi. I'm head of cloud security at Netflix. My team has been actively involved in the open source community. We have contributed about 7 to 8 tools over the past 2 years. I'm really looking forward to this panel and a great discussion because this is a topic I'm very passionate about.
Peter? Hi, my name is Peter Manev. I am a chief strategy officer of Stamus Networks. We are an NDR vendor. I'm also part of the executive team at OISF, and I've been part of the open source community around Suricata since the early days back in 2009. Very proud contributor too, and looking forward to actually more discussions like this, and we regularly actually contribute back to the open source via different tools and similar things, especially on GitHub and other. So I'm very thankful and grateful to be here. Thank you.
I'm Ted Ipsen with a Positroniq consultancy. A lot of my clients are actually in the small and medium-sized business range, and you know, open source security tools are a lifesaver for those kinds of organizations because they simply don't have the ability to purchase, you know, a $50,000 a year commercial license for some kind of enterprise tool like that. So I definitely am passionate about being able to help what is often an underserved, I think, part of the market and improve their security, telemetry, and so on using open source tools.
So just to give you all a sense of the run of show, we're gonna have a dialogue up here. It's gonna be a lot of just conversing. I do have some questions, of course, but our hope is to just learn from the experiences of all of these gentlemen around this topic. Then we'll leave some time for questions, so hopefully you guys have some questions. And then I'm gonna leave a few minutes for each of them to give you some takeaways to go back into your organizations with. And know that we'll probably linger outside the room afterwards, so if you have continued conversations or ideas on how we can continue this conversation or things maybe we didn't think about, please let us know. But I think one of the things that inspired more of this, particularly as the call for talks at RSA opened up, was of course the Log4j event that kind of propelled the open source community into the spotlight in probably not the way we were hoping. And I think it started to elevate some questions with, I know, consortium members with OISF and others in the open source community about, you know, how, what are some of the stories, the successes and maybe misses of bringing open source technologies into large and small enterprise environments? What are some of those stories that, you know, maybe have percolated since the Log4j event and maybe even before? But who would like to kick off?
So I guess I'd say that Log4j is just one example, of course, but the level of visibility that that open source products have in critical roles in organizations of all different sizes and across various industries. Obviously, that came into really sharp focus there, right? And I think that overall, a lot of the level of scrutiny around things that are like, you know, SBOM, right, the software bill of materials and so on, organizations that are relying on software that they didn't write have concerns, right? And it's always hard to, particularly when you start to get risk management folks involved into the conversation, getting over that kind of conceptual hurdle of, well, if there's a problem with this software, who do I sue, right? And that's like becomes a really difficult conversation to have with executive management, with legal team, and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, whether you're building a product that has open source technologies bolted in or a large enterprise environment like Netflix, there are more challenges around how do you have those conversations and how do you kind of alleviate the legal fears as well as the risk management fears, as well as, oh my God, what if something goes sideways? What do we do?
Yeah, so open source has been a boon, right? So it has let us innovate faster. It has given us a tremendous business advantage to innovate faster. And you don't have to really like staff up and build everything from scratch. So it gives us a baseline for us to start with. But as Kelley was mentioning, we do need some way of understanding what do you have in your environment and what kind of debt you have by depending on this open source libraries. And also from a legal standpoint, where do you stand in terms of your requirements, and are you going to get into trouble if you don't know the vulnerabilities that exist in open source libraries? And in those cases, it really is important to understand your footprint and also be ready for Log4j-like events so that we can do mass remediation really, really quickly. At Netflix, we are a big fan of being prepared for the worst scenario, so we do these tabletop exercises on, oh, let's say this widely used library that is gonna get compromised, right? So what does that actually mean for us to go ahead and quickly remediate? First of all, identifying where are all the places in our environment it exists, and what is the criticality? We are also a big fan of doing risk-based remediation. So we don't go at once and remediate all of them at once. We will go risk-based tiered approach. This is tier zero, highly risky. So this one would have an SLA of 1 day. We're gonna go remediate. And then the next year would be like 5 days. The next year would be like 15 days, right? So we're gonna come up with a tiered approach. That's the only way small security teams can get ahead and then help out with mass remediation, reduce risk to the business.
I love the tabletop exercise sort of analogy and practice within Netflix. That's a really exciting way to sort of bring that to the enterprise. And just so you all know, like my hope is that you'll take away some of these tidbits. If I had a whiteboard, I'd say tabletop exercise. Tidbit number one, take it away. Peter.
Well, I totally agree, follow up with the colleagues here, but just a couple of points from me. Whether you would like to adopt open source or not, most likely you've already done it just by looking at your TV, for example, or driving your car. There's open source, first of all, open source software or some sort of a tool or some sort of a library is kind of everywhere. Even commercial vendors, most of it use it. I'm pretty sure you've heard all about Apache, Linux OS, and similar software. It's just everywhere. So to some extent, whether you know it or not, you're probably already using it. Now, usually one of the differences is that, yes, okay, CVEs come and go, and like the Log4j, they'll be the next one anytime now, I guess. They come and go, and not only with open source, but with commercial tools and vendors as well. It's just a weekly occurrence, and one of them are big, others are small. But the difference usually is that when you have a commercial vendor, usually they take responsibility of any and all tooling that they have in their software or appliances or services or whatever that is. And if you're actually directly utilizing open source software or libraries, just like, for example, as you mentioned, you need to take the extra steps of making sure that you're covered just in case if you need to do that. And the way you do that is via, very simple, via dialogue, I think, to those communities. To the open source communities and similar things.
No, I do think, you know, earlier when we were prepping, you know, the notion came up that, I think, Kelley, you said that sometimes the licensing arrangements are a bit like Russian roulette, right? And you don't know exactly what you're going to get. And there's no uniformity across the different communities on how they do their licensing. So that can certainly add additional legal and, you know, risk management types of headaches into the equation.
Which actually might be a talk to submit for next year's RSA. Let's navigate the crazy roadmap of open source licenses and try and get our arms around it. Because it does, it adds that level of complexity around it. You know, when you're looking at open source, you're looking at technology, code base, right? People, licenses, community, all of those different aspects. So just sort of plugging into the human part of open source, what have been your experiences of working with those communities, or how to best sort of manage the human element of open source?
I guess I'd say that, you know, most communities are really great, and they're really really receptive to feedback and, you know, feature requests and those kinds of things, which is super helpful. I think one of the key elements, though, is making sure that you aren't approaching open source development communities as if they were a commercial enterprise, and that you were, you know, well, I'm a paying customer, damn it, right? and so don't approach it as a consumer. Approach it as a partner. Approach as a an evangelist, right? And so that you're giving back, you're contributing back at least as much as you're getting from the product.
Yeah, there is this huge, adding on to that, right? There's this huge imbalance, right? 80% are consumers and 20% are producers, or maybe even less. And so whenever we put out an open source tool out there, open source library out there, there's a lot more consumers and very few producers. And on the producing side as well, that we have bandwidth constraints. It's not that we are there to make the open source library successful as the primary goal. We have like business risks to take care of and security companies to run, security programs to mature, and there are other things that actually come in the way. So anything that we can do to invite participation from the community is always going to be helpful. And there are, I think we were also talking about it this morning, that having some kind of a metrics around the success of that would be good. It's not just followers you have on GitHub for your open source library. Can we at least say, oh, this particular feature that was not built by Netflix is being now used by Netflix? That's a success right there, because you crowdsourced your problem, somebody else wrote code for you in your library that Netflix is benefiting from. So in that way, I think that kind of a fostering is important, but that all starts with proper onboarding and being able to invite them for participation, give them a little bit control in the say on how this library or system is going to evolve, as opposed to controlling. It's like, oh, this is rigid, this is the way it should be, otherwise we don't want to be going down that path. That holds, that kind of curtails creativity and innovation, I feel.
I think that goes a long way, yeah, right? Because like you mentioned GitHub and things like that. One of the advantages of open source tools is actually the idea sharing, because the code is out there, right? So anybody can actually use it, but there's a lot of different perspectives of that use that not So for example, that the code owner or the code contributor didn't necessarily think about, but there's a lot of cases. So actually, one way to effectively communicate is like, give feedback, you know, because that actually helps a lot. Just from personal experience, when you put a project out there, you keep wondering, okay, so is it good, is it not good? So giving a star on GitHub, okay, somebody's using it, good. Giving a feedback, that's not working, that's even better because now I know what's not working. So now that project has some sort of a feedback, or think of it as a free QA. So that's great of engaging that part of the community, right? So then you become kind of a member by doing that of the community, and by that your channel of communication really opens. As opposed to, you know, just as you mentioned, as approach as an evangelist, I'm a user, this is my use case, that's working, that's not working. You actually engage and you're useful, you give feedback. And as opposed to, you know, I'm a paying customer, it is not working, you know, that's not really effective. But usually those communities are actually open to receive any sort of feedback and communication, and it goes a long way. And it's so easy actually to do it, so easy. A lot of people usually have a, you know, that breaking the ice barrier, but that's actually so easy to do in most of the cases, I think.
I also think you can go a step further from that, right? So you can include open source footprint in your bug bounty scope. You can include that into your red team exercises scope. And when you find problems in those open source libraries, share that and share the fixes in the libraries. So that's essentially why you're learning, you're contributing, at the same time you're giving back to the community. It doesn't have to be code, it could be fixes. It could be just findings and feedback, as Peter was mentioning. That is like another way to at least make sure that the community is healthy.
So actually, if you do that in an open source community or project, I think by default you become like a platinum member or something. You just like, because that's really valued, right? Really, really valuable input.
Well, and if you think about sort of the difference of, you know, your relationships with commercial partners, commercial entities, and we're a fan of them as well, but it's different. There are some commonalities, but it's how you almost mentally approach the relationship, right? So, you know, take like maybe the worst case scenario that whoever is kind of the head developer or kind of the heart and soul of that open source code base, what if they go off the rails? You know, how do you know that? And how do you mitigate that kind of risk? And, you know, because I think that's part of the scariness. A lot of commercial products, you can go, oh, I'm gonna go sue you. But in open source, if somebody just kind of loses their mind and, you know, says, see you later, I'm not gonna even look at this code anymore, what happens then?
Well, I think that's part of why you need to have a healthy community around it, right? So it's not so heavily reliant on one or two sort of shining stars, you know? Mm-hmm. Those people are always going to kind of come out. But having a much more vibrant community around the product, whatever it is, helps you mitigate some of that risk. And also you get more eyes on the code base too, because even if somebody loses their mind, maybe they're not necessarily being malicious, right? But they start just making silly mistakes or whatever, right? So having that healthy community where you've just got lots of eyes and people are actively participating, I think helps with that.
Are there ways that you all would suggest vetting the community or getting to know the community? Like what are some of those ways that you would do that if you were introduced to, you know, an amazing open source technology, Suricata, that you might want to adopt into your enterprise? How would you go about vetting that community?
Yeah, I would say start with the reputation of the community, right? Looking at the historical aspects of like who is the primary contributor or which team is behind it, what are the adopters? Like communities like ClickHouse and communities like Kubernetes and Envoy, right? There has been widely adopted across the board. So clearly there is a vibrant community around that. So how active is it? Reputation and generally thinking around the familiarity of and the operations of it, right? So it's kind of, it doesn't have to be that bus factor problem you mentioned. Oh, there's this one person. So the entire community is dependent on this one person, right? So that is not a healthy thing. So one thing that we do at Netflix is we hold a very high bar for open source dependencies, like new open source dependencies. We essentially ask the same questions, like what we do for commercial software. If you are buying a product, you go get referrals, you go get a check on their reputation, you do the decision analysis to determine is it worth the price, do they have a support team, right? So you do all this vetting, but for open source, it's freedom and responsibility, right? You just go ahead and run up command, and that becomes part of your environment. So instead, as security leaders, what we can do is provide a framework to bring in, to intake new open source libraries. And then build from source, make sure that you have stronger identities of the commits that you are actually going to roll out in production. And also, I'm very bullish about one of these new things that is coming out of Google, the assured open source software that they announced, I think about two to three weeks ago. And that's amazing, right? Because they essentially take the libraries that they depend on from an open source perspective, they analyze them, they scan them, they fuzz test them, they also make sure that it is distributed in a way that it is protected by Google so that the assurance aspect is there, and that is another way to raise the bar against this malicious code or things that is falling off the tracks and depending on that as an extra risk to your business.
And there's usually some open dialogue with the communities anyway, yeah. Right?
Absolutely, I think that's essential. I think it starts there in general. Finding a clear communication channel or a clear group of folks to talk to speak about what your worries are, what your requirements are, you know, why you're actually doing this, and you might actually find real easy to how good of a feedback you'll get right away, and get most of your questions answered right away. I think one way also to gauge communities, just like in a lot of cases, there's like some sort of a Slack channel or Discord channel or some sort of a mailing list or something that you can actually, usually it's public, mm-hmm. and you can actually see what the active status are, the active contributions and similar things, and then you can gauge the health of the project. If you have, the bigger the community usually brings more ideas and similar things, but that takes time, right? So it doesn't happen today. So, and usually if you find an open source project that has been out there for a few years, it means in general that it's kind of healthy and useful, especially with the community members around it and all that stuff. And I agree, commercial companies often do that. And sometimes in the open source projects that we're involved with, a lot of the questions are like, you know, how is your quality assurance? You know, fuzzing, testing, all those sorts of things. Is everything okay? And that's mainly not, and I think that's mainly more driven of what needs to be taken care of when, so that you're actually clear of what needs to be done. And that's quite okay. And I think here the open source community should actually not be afraid to answer and be clear of what and why they're doing these things. It's quite okay. In a lot of cases, you'll find that big commercial organizations are often enough actually a source of help if you approach mm-hmm. the right way, the right communication and all that stuff, because it's mutual benefit actually, yeah. In a lot of cases, I think.
So certainly there's that symbiotic relationship, right, where to your point, if you are building in a critical dependency on some open source library, for example, you do need to be, as an enterprise, pretty robust in your needs analysis and determining what to the degree you can the provenance of that source code and so on, right? And treating it just as you would with the same level of robustness when planning to use a commercial product, right? But just in this case, it happens to be open source. But yeah, the whole idea of engaging early and often to try, you know, to judge the health of that community, I think is critical.
It's almost like having, you know, you have a playbook for onboarding commercial partners, right?
Yeah.
Why not have a playbook for onboarding open source technologies? Particularly when you have a developer who just downloads it and then tells you after the fact. Have any of you experienced that before, where you've had a developer just like go out, download something, oh, by the way, I'm now using this, maybe we should go check it out. then a lot of people start getting scared. But the conversations inside the organizations tend to hit in different pockets, the legal folks, the development teams, maybe the marketing teams, if they're going to be open and upfront about using an open source technology, and the business decision makers. So there are lots of pockets, which puts maybe some of the ownership on the project, on the open source community to step in and have a better relationship and be better prepared of working with enterprise environments. So if you all were speaking to an open source project, what would you say to them, just kind of as balance to the conversation?
Yeah, I think that, as Peter said, it's mutually beneficial to both sides of the equation, right? If a project gets adopted by large enterprises and gets successful, right, in that way, and becomes a very popular tool and so on, but it has to be a dialogue where the members of the community really listen to what the intended use case is for that given enterprise, and they really understand what the needs are for the project, and maybe that means that they need to make a specific fork or something, possibly, but it's definitely critical that not just be a one-way street, right? That is a true dialogue between both sides, so they both understand what's reasonable expectations on each side of the table too.
Yeah, I think clear dialogue helps to manage the expectation of why actually you're asking and what are you into, and that's very, very, very critical. And this is, again, feedback to open source community is very, very healthy, to be very honest. And so, for example, even given the commercial perspective, is actually very healthy back to a project. So an open source project can really benefit. Usually most of them do it, but in general, I think any open source project benefits a lot with things like change management. You do regular releases and you announce what's in that release, what's a breaking change, what's things. So that actually helps a lot understanding, okay, where are we going? Where are you going with this? So any help managing also expectations and understanding better on both sides. And that helps a lot on commercial adaptation, so to speak, at least in my view.
And seeing the roadmap, I am totally biased, I admit it, I'm okay with it. But honestly, when we're talking to large enterprises, saying that you get to see the development roadmap, you get to have a say in what things are coming down in the development cycle, come to Suricon, have the conversation with us. That's a very different mindset for a lot of enterprise environments to say, well, I'm not sure. Maybe I can ask for something. Maybe I can't. Maybe it's just for us. How does that balance? But, how do those conversations sort of happen in the large environment space?
Yeah, so we have built a healthy community around this open source project called Spinnaker, and that is essentially how we run that entire community, right? We have a Spinnaker Con that happens every year. The people come together, they get voted on, there's a governing body around it. So it's essentially, we want to make sure that we don't break anybody's use case, but at the same time, we want to make sure that it's a healthy ecosystem, it's maturing as we go around, right? So I think as Ted and Peter were also saying, maybe there is a lack of standardization. Some people care about change management. Some people care about not getting into legal troubles, right? Is there a way, and of course, as OSF can help in these areas, and it's good to see big players like Google also getting behind OSF. So maybe I think with Log4j kind of events in the rear view, I would say some kind of standardization is coming. That is going to be super, super helpful in just talking about apples to apples as opposed to apples to oranges, right?
So there are many instances where open source technologies are built into those commercial products. And I'm going to direct this at my dear friend, Peter Manev, and which adds that layer of complexity, right, to an enterprise having a commercial product with open source bolted in. how does that conversation happen in the enterprise environment for how to just have the level of awareness as well as how to mitigate any concerns or risks?
Yeah, sure. actually, I do have a bit of experience, at least in my line of duty, so to speak, my line of work of adopting like Suricata in large enterprises and similar. And it's always kind of usually the similar question. So the approach is, you know, who do we call when the house is on fire, you know, so to speak? How do we kind of a simple, clear communication in terms of, let's say, support or something like that? Is there an established process, or who do we actually can contact if we need help with something? You know, for example, it couldn't just be like, you know, not necessarily in terms of SLAs, but in terms of who can we contact? Is there trainings that we can go to? How can we make sure that we're prepared for everything? Or if we need to like emergency patch the system, what's the best way to approach that? If we need to report a bug or an issue, how do we do it? Is there a private channel for reporting that or a public? I mean, of course there's public because it's open source, but sometimes you might want to report, let's say, a critical bug that you want to disclose after the patch is ready and out. So that helps, that goes along. Being able to answer all those questions actually helps a lot. Being able to actually go to enterprise organization and say, there's an open source project here, and these questions are already answered, and they deal with it like that. So you're already a step ahead, I would say. And combined with the stuff that, there is an open conversation dialogue, why you do it and what you want to do, that actually helps a lot on the reverse side, so on the open source project, to manage the expectation. Because usually when you get contacted as an open source project, for example, for somebody big, the general expectation is like, oh my God, like, it's not always like that, you know. There is reasons for that, and you just have to manage the expectation. But again, being open on what you want to do and why you want to do, that's the first step, goes a long way. But the open source project, being able to actually provide feedback in terms of roadmap, you know, change management, releases, trainings, some sort of support services or support line of communication, some sort of, let's say, an emergency line just in case, you know. Not necessarily an emergency line in terms of SLA, as I mentioned, but hey, how do we report something critical that we found? And in a lot of cases, this goes a very long way, because the open source usually project looks for a lot of feedback. Okay, so you've installed our system in your environment, right? That open source software is looking for feedback. Okay, what are the problems? What are the things? If they get that information, again, you're achieving as an enterprise adopter a better status of kind of supporter evangelist, and that helps a lot, the communication both ways. That just goes a long way in my experience.
Yeah, I think that one of the key things on the enterprise side is making sure that as an organization, you really understand what it is you expect out of that particular software that you're using, right? Because as you mentioned, Kelley, some dev could have just downloaded this thing, like, hey, this is the new hotness, right? Whatever this library is, and they don't really know how it works or what it does. And, you know, that way danger lies, right? Potentially. So really being clear about what the expectations are from an enterprise. Why are we looking at adopting this particular technology? And what are our expectations short term and then long term as we engage with the community and so on?
Yeah, and to pivot off of that, you know, the old adage that, you know, open source is not free beer or free beer. I forget what it is. It's like close to happy hour, folks, let's be honest. What's that?
As in beer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Free as in freedom, not beer. Yeah. So, you know, I think in lots of cases, large enterprises will, of course, it's free. Let's try it out. Let's see if it works. But there's a cost inside the organization, and I'm going to point to the Netflix folks to say, what is the cost to the organization? And like, how do you add that into the calculation of whether or not an open source solution, how's that sort of compared to maybe a commercial solution?
Yeah, and this is something that I really deeply care about, that particular problem, right? Being inside an organization like Netflix, who is very active in the open source community, we also have restrictions on bandwidth and lean teams with huge charters. That is a reality today. And given that, I think there is a balance that is always that we need to get out of an engagement like this, right? We don't set out to create an open source community. We don't set out to make, my primary goal of this engineer is to make this open source community successful and thrive. That is one of the goals, but we also want to make sure that the business succeeds by investing in these areas, right? So I think balance is important. For example, on my teams, one thing that I do is I hold a high bar for the quality of the software we put out there. We are not going to open source anything that is just built by one developer. That means we are creating that bus factor problem, and if that person leaves or that person gets hit by a bus or whatever, right, then we have a problem, and we'll be scrambling to keep it up and running, especially after a healthy community has been built around it. So we would at least need 2 to 3 people, and the way I call it is, let's open source responsibly. And one of the things is to make sure that there are more than one person who is knowledgeable, and then we have enough bandwidth, which is about 20% is what I recommend for this, along with your everything else that's on your plate. And as leaders, we need to create that space, right? We don't have to say, you've given you 100% and this 20% is your extra time. That is not going to be successful. We need to say, okay, it's 80% and 20%, now let's go make it happen. And that has helped us, and it's every team is different, but it's good to have those guardrails in place and think about it.
And vice versa, you know, what do open source projects need from the enterprise? You know, we've talked about feedback, but what else can, because it needs to be that partnership.
Actually, often enough, to be very honest, different open source projects utilize other open source tools, libraries, mm-hmm. and things, and you'll be surprised how much of a long way it goes. Like when you have a big organization, like open sourcing, something. So I think one way you could look at it is like when you open source something as a big organization, you actually get a lot of feedback. If it's useful, you know. And by way of doing that is actually there's a lot of testers actually out there, and you get a lot of ideas back of what's working, what's not, and similar things. And you have other open source software that might use that library. Mm-hmm. But the fact of the matter is that open source software uses a lot of other open source projects, yep. and things. And by clearly communicating, actually, it helps a lot more communities and similar things. And open source, actually, software has a similar problem to the commercial organizations. You know, if a specific project wants to adopt, let's say, a new tool or a new library, so to speak, the same questions come up. Exactly. Is it supported? How long can we count on it? Is it more than one person? Can we actually establish a contact and see how they're doing, request some feedback and similar things? So the exact same questions come right up usually in those cases, I think.
Yeah, I want to hear Ted's thoughts, but I just want to jump in there for a minute because I was on a webinar probably like 6 months ago, and you know, rightfully so, I was just kind of trolling the webinar because of my work at OISF. And someone on the webinar said, open source projects never have support services. And I think one of the things that, you know, I've been hearing in this conversation is that support looks different. If you need help with open source, you may not have that formal support services agreement. What you might have is a community through a Slack channel or Discord or places where you can go to for help. You won't be left out in the cold. And I think that's part of that kind of, you know, the mindset around engaging with commercial products versus the mindset around open source. One is not necessarily better or worse than the other. They're different. And approaching it from the enterprise needs to come from almost a different headspace.
Yeah, well, I think it is going back to the idea of being an active participant in the conversation, right? Mm-hmm. And not just simply consuming what comes out of the project, and often you'll even find because if it is a healthy community, you'll get even better engagement and better support than you might, you know, otherwise, like from a, even from some commercial vendors, perhaps, because you have just passionate, active people who are there who want the project to succeed. And you know, when you, if you point out that there's an issue, they're happy to jump in and help you try to figure out, you know, a solution.
And it goes back to the incentivizing model, right? So I think the way you can build a support, a healthy support model around an OSS project for success is to incentivize that from the contributors themselves, right? So the community should contribute, they should cheer them up and should kind of be able to provide the right incentives to encourage that kind of a maturity and around open source. And if you say, hey, this is the last thing, right, do it on your weekends or on your days off, then I think that is not going to happen. And that's where you tend to cut corners, and that builds tech debt, and that's not good for the community, and it just dies down.
So I have one more question before we close out the panel. So I'm gonna hold it for the very end to give these guys the last word. So let's open it up for some questions, because I know you all have questions, come on. Mics around, or just shout it out. Come sit up on stage if you'd like. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Claire. I work as a software engineer at a tech company in San Francisco called Samsara, and I really care a lot about like free and open source software in my work. So how do you, as leaders, move your organization forward and advocate for upstreaming changes, like contributing back to open source software that you use, versus like, I don't know, keeping a secret moat or competitive advantage is like the other mindset that other people might see?
Yeah, I can definitely take that, and we definitely we have seen that as a common pattern. At Netflix, at least, open source is not our bread and butter, right? So there is no reason for us to keep some of this technology under the wraps, right? That's one way. Of course, if it's at Google, and if you are talking about the search algorithm, that they keep it very close to the heart, then it makes sense to keep it away from competitors. So there is a reason. The second thing is legal requirements. If you are depending on a software that requires you to contribute back, that might be another way that you can essentially get support from your leadership using the legal angle to make room for contributing upstream changes back to the community. Those are the two things I can think of. Peter, Ted?
Yeah, sure. Actually, pardon me. At least on our side, contributing back is very essential because by that you actually are getting to be better known in the community, who you are, and it's sort of you quickly achieve a lot more outreach, people actually come back at you with more ideas and similar things, and you have a direct exposure to a bunch of bright minds out there that actually otherwise you would not have just as a separate commercial organization. Then one of the big points of open source is exactly that, is just unconditional different bright ideas capability, right? Because actually it's out there, let's say, for example, on GitHub, and anybody can actually use it, and there's a lot of different angles it could be done. For us, on our end, on the commercial side, it's essential for us to give back, because by doing that as well, we keep the project healthy and in track with the current trends, and we give a lot of feedback from the, so to speak, commercial line of thinking to the open source project, and that helps. It helps that cycle of giving back and forth and keeping things healthy, actually. So it is essential, because you would want that open source tool or project to be doing good, actually, because you're using it at the very least.
Thank you.
Claire, since you're a software engineer, right, so one thing that I've used at Netflix is being able to spin it off as a career growth opportunity for your own personal branding, right? Mm-hmm. And that actually helps the recruiting machine to hire great talent.
Yeah.
And that is the indirect benefit that you can actually get, and that might resonate well with your leadership to make room for these upstream changes.
I think, you know, by approaching it that way, you are able to then articulate the greater value that the software is bringing to your organization, right? And then it's that virtuous kind of loop, right, of feeding back into the life cycle of the product, and you're increasing the value of that product for everyone who wants to use it.
and it can be fun. You know, honestly, engaging in the open source world can be fun and inspiring and innovative and
bragging rights, everything.
Bragging rights and free T-shirts.
There's no money on that. The bragging rights. You cannot buy it.
But yes. I'll just add one more sort of plug. Though one of the things that we do at OISF, and that I try to advocate in the women in cybersecurity space, is that if there are folks that are interested in security and software development, particularly, I always point them to open source. First, to say go get to know it, you know, practice your skills, learn something. We connect with an organization called Outreachy that helps to train underserved populations to enter the security space, developers. And it's really exciting because I think they don't feel as pressured as if they were to go into a big enterprise environment. They come into a small open source community, they can kind of get their feet wet a little bit. And that's been really exciting. But, you know, we always say we'll vet the project for you too, just to make sure it's a good place.
But. Yeah, just mine is dealing with the C-level. I'm not gonna, I've built the whole environment, back office for worldwide company, and to help build that, and that was all Linux and all Linux based, and it works beautiful and still works beautiful. And then I transitioned to a nationwide company who the C-level, the CISO is like, no, who are we gonna sue, right? How vulnerable are we gonna be? And we don't have time for that. And vendors, you know, the CIO is, let's get a vendor and walk away. But, you know, how do we defeat that mindset? I've been trying, but it's not working. You know, how do you deal with the C-level mindset that does not have any idea about the process of dealing with open source?
Yeah, I think that, and I say this on about a lot of things in security, where you need to go back to the why you're trying to do that thing, and then that will help you get to the how, potentially, right? And so, In that case, it's defining, helping to paint the picture and articulate what the real value is of that open source project that you want to use, and working through the risk assessment process with the C-level folks, right, or with upper management, to paint that picture of, you know, it's like the potential benefit outweighs the potential downside, if you can reasonably articulate that for the particular scenario. But helping them to understand it, all of the upside, potential upside, in using open source software and open source technologies, while, you know, acknowledging that yes, they do have some valid concerns, and it is often easier to just say, hey, we have a contract with a vendor and we can sue this vendor if things go badly, right, that kind of thing. But again, going back to being very clear about why you want to use a particular open source technology and being able to articulate the real value proposition there, I think, is key.
I'm also a big fan of pitching open source as a viable alternative to vendor solutions. Whenever you do a decision log to bring in a vendor, right, consider a few open source offerings as well and debate it out. Operations model, SOC compliance, like all kinds of things, and do apples to apples comparison and present that to the C-suite and see if there is a data-driven way to influence them to essentially say, hey, yes, open source, this is the active community that's there and this is the support burden we're gonna take, but we're gonna save all these dollars. Right, and vendors don't come for free. It also needs to be managed, right? There's a relationship angle, there is the contract renewal angle, there is a whole bunch of things that goes with vendors as well. So doing that comparison is always going to be, is just going to make it clear for everybody. Maybe it'll also help you determine, is that the right thing? Should I be doing open source for the sake of open source, or is it really a viable alternative that my organization can benefit?
Sounds like that playbook, due diligence, you know, examples. We have to wrap up. I just want to give them each 20 seconds each. The future of open source. Are more open source projects going to be emerging? Are more enterprises going to be using it? You know, where are we going, do you think?
Yeah, I think that there is going to be more adoption by enterprises. I think one of the challenges, though, is, again, in the area of like supply chain problem, right? And really being able to demonstrate for if you have regulatory requirements or whatever, that you're appropriately handling the risk related to that.
I think it's one of the greatest benefits is like magnet of innovation and ideas.
Yeah.
It cannot possibly, very difficult on the commercial side to come into that level of what is out there, just because by definition it's very versatile, very dispersed, lots of ideas. It is actually super beneficial.
Yeah, I would say it's not a choice. It's almost a necessity for us with the dependency on open source, and we probably need to lean more in, but lean more in a way that it's more calculated. You're not blindly leaning in, but you're aware of the risks you're taking, and then know what you're taking on. That would be my direction.
Well, thanks everybody for coming. Thank you to my panelists. It was as much fun prepping as actually doing this. And now I've got a list of about 6 more talks to talk to Ed about for next year. But thanks everybody for being here, and we'll probably be outside if you want to ask any more questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.